Ladies and gentlemen, Fighting Fit, the Mouthcast.
On this edition, one quarter of a band who rose to prominence in the mid-1990s. Though often lumped in with the celebratory Britpop scene, his band strived for grander things, so stood apart as something a little more refined. Almost 20 years on, all five studio albums, including the defining Olympian, are about to be reissued as deluxe double disc editions. Now a successful London-based wine merchant, but once drummer in Gene. Matt James, welcome to the Mouthcast.
Hi Steve, how are you doing?
Do you often have to do that, switch heads as it were?
It is quite weird. They're two sort of very different worlds. It was a kind of hobby of mine, really. I didn't massively like it before I could afford any. but I think after I got the Polydor record deal, I got a taste of the nice red wine. And I don't know, it seemed to stick with me, really. It kind of ended up being my job, really. My hobby and job just swapped places. I still sort of do music, but it's not my main income anymore. I work from home in an office at home, and I can slip between the two worlds quite easily. One minute I'm like, you know, selling some wine to a gastro pub. The next minute I'm doing an interview on the phone for Gene. You know, I really like that. That's a nice position to be in. There's nobody overlooking my shoulder going, get back to selling wine, you know.
Give me something I can hold. That's something I will grow. Make me crazy with your arms. It's all gone hazy. It's all gone.
Matt, all five studio albums by Gene have been remastered and are about to be reissued. In the past, Martin's been quite outspoken about not reforming the band, and he's declined to be involved with these reissues, preferring to draw a line under it and look ahead, I guess. You've all moved on, but what was the general feeling between you, Steve and Kev? Was it agreed that it was now time for this to happen?
I think it's not necessarily sort of right time, it's right label, really. Over the years, other people have approached us about reforming. You know, there's always like gigs on the table and things, but I think we all know that's not going to happen. You know, as you say, like Martin has always wanted to draw a very firm line under it, and I think the rest of us totally respect that. And I don't think we could really do Gene unless all four of us were like firing on all cylinders. And certainly knowing that one of them didn't particularly want to do it, and another one is kind of maybe, you know, that's not the way to go about a band. But in terms of the reissues, Demon came to us. They didn't just want to put Olympian out. A couple of people have said, can we re-release Olympian? And they actually wanted to do the whole catalogue, which meant that we could do Libertine, which was our final LP, which we did on our own label. And that's quite an important record to us. The other thing is that because we don't actually own our catalogue, Universal owned the first four LPs. These things can happen whether you like it or not, whether, you know, Martin wants it or any of the band wants it. But the good thing is we were able to put something into it, give them some unreleased material, and it also gave us an opportunity to kind of have a look over the rest of the releases, make sure the artwork was good, and, you know, just to be involved, because in the past, we haven't been involved at all in
the releases. It's clear the records have been treated with a lot of respect as well.
Yeah, I feel that. They seem like professional guys who are kind of genuine fans who want to do it properly, really. So the thought, you know, I was able to sort of go in and search through backstage passes and just give them something to, you know, that otherwise they'll be just searching around for generic images of things they think are Gene, and I've noticed that Polydor, who we were signed to ourselves, have been done that. And they couldn't even, it's much easier for them not to bother to get the band involved, really.
So with being that involved with putting the deluxe editions together, has it been a case of sifting through old tapes that you've been keeping in a box under your bed or in the wardrobe? And has much come out of that that surprised you? Have you found things that you'd forgotten about?
I did do quite a lot of that. There's not too much for the first four LPs that really is around. But in terms of the Libertine, the final LP, I went through mini discs and, you know, I found sort of tracks that we'd really forgotten about. And I haven't listened to a lot of the music for quite a long time anyway. There are certain demos and things that are pretty high quality. I'm sure some of the fans have heard some of them, you know, and I think they probably have passed around. I don't know how they got them. Maybe sort of tapes from studios where we recorded may have been sort of lost somewhere and found. You know, the really hardcore fans know about most of their recordings, but not all of them. There are some that are literally on mini discs in my house only, you know. In terms of the first four LPs, I did actually find one of the greatest things I found was the Olympian four-track demos, which we had before we were signed. I remember I used to drive across South London to Steve's house in Kingston, and that's where we worked on a little four-track studio. I did actually find those demos, but those are not on the Olympian LP. There was a sort of contractual thing where I think Universal probably think that they own them, but they certainly don't have them, and they weren't leaving my bedroom without some sort of payment. But you know, maybe they might surface in the future, I'm not too sure.
Well, let's go back to 1994, those first couple of singles, For the Dead, Be My Light, Be My Guide. Listening back to those and all those great B-sides on the compilation To See the Light, Gene seemed to arrive fully formed, a really good live band, a tight unit with a lot of confidence,
yeah,
and plenty of really solid material.
It wasn't really like that. It actually took me 10 years to get a proper record deal. You know, I thought I'd do it when I was 18. I was actually 29 when it did. Steve and Martin were early 20s, 21, 22 sort of thing. But when Martin initially joined, we were another band called Spin. And we sort of made our mistakes in that Martin tried to learn the, you know, the songs of a former band member. And we sort of went on the road a little bit as Spin. And we kind of made our mistakes there. Then we realised that we really weren't that band anymore. We really need to come up with a new sound and new concept. And then even that took quite a while to develop. It wasn't until we wrote For the Dead itself that we realised we had this Faces-influenced music with Martin Smith's influence. The vocal thing, and we actually got a fantastic hybrid, which was Gene, really. It was kind of our own sound, and it didn't come just like that.
Not quite the average indie sound either, with songs like For the Dead and Olympian, both always well received when you played them live. As songs and the band's sound, did you realise early on that you were onto something really special?
Yeah, For the Dead was a turning point. That one came first. And it was a great opportunity to actually wipe the slate clean. I've heard the songs we had before then, you know, from the demos I've just mentioned to you, that they didn't have that sound. For the Dead gave us a blueprint, and we just thought, right, let's do more like that, and let's just have this sort of slightly loose feel about the way we're writing. And same influences, but we just kind of kicked back, realised what we needed to do. And from that point, the other songs, I Can't Help Myself and Olympian, Be My Light, Be My Guide, and all those things came after that. So it was a seminal moment for us, and that's why we released the For the Dead demo, which actually was just a drum machine. What I used to do is sit and write with Steve and Kev with guitars, and then we would have to make a demo. I actually got brilliant at programming drum machines like I was actually playing, so I would actually sort of just record it semi-live as though they were samples. So I mean, it was a strange way of using a drum machine, and the rest of the band's playing on top of it. But it still had a sort of fantastic loose feel about it that I managed to program in on the drums.
I would say Gene's closest contemporaries in terms of music were the Blue Tones, similar influences at play, and both bands stood outside of the scene that they apparently belonged to. And the Blue Tones all shared a house in which they would write, demo, rehearse. Quite a hothouse environment. Was it like that for Gene? Was it that intense?
We certainly didn't live together. We had weekly rehearsals in a proper rehearsal studio, but we did so much demoing, literally every day. We were doing it like a proper job, nine till five, and off to the pub and then listen to it later, type thing. When we got on tour, we were together all the time at that point. But we didn't take it that far. We lived all over different parts of London. Like Kevin and I lived in Brockley in South London, which is one side of South London. Steve lived in Kingston, which is completely the other side. Martin cycled from Watford, literally. It just showed the determination that we had. We actually to meet up all the time. Martin didn't come down to all of the writing sessions. He'd come to one or two a week, and then the rest of the three of us would sort of work on the music. He'd be sort of working on lyrics a little bit up in Watford, and then we'd meet up. So no, we weren't a gang like the Blue Tones. I think they'd all sort of been to school together, and I'm not quite sure about that, but I know they were very tight as a unit. We also were a different age as well. Like, I'd been in a band with Steve's brother, and I was a bit older than Steve and Martin. Kev was sort of my age, Martin and Steve were the young guys, and me and Kev were the older guys in the band. So it wasn't like a school gang, if you know what I mean.
You just mentioned Martin's Smiths influence. There were, of course, a lot of comparisons for Gene to the Smiths. I imagine that was greeted with wry smiles, but the general press reaction to the band, how did that affect you? Because they were openly hostile on occasion towards Martin, and I particularly remember a little bit later on the Drawn to the Deep End album getting an absolute panning, which didn't really seem objective.
Yeah, it was quite upsetting, The Enemy especially had built us up and given us loads of press and very quickly decided it would be quite fun to shoot us down, really. I mean, I'd actually recently over Christmas done an interview with The Enemy, they are actually reassessing their review of Olympian, and they're doing a piece next week, the 27th, called Anatomy of an Album. I haven't read the piece, but they have said that they've quoted their original review, and I think they may. I can't say for sure because I haven't read it, but I think they are reassessing their review. I don't know whether they'll do it with Drawn to the Deep End. Martin was actually quite depressed during that time, and they sort of insinuated that he was making that up to sell records, and he really was very ill, and it really, really wasn't fair of them to do that. Yes, it was a bit upsetting at times.
Well, Drawn to the Deep End in 1997 was a really masterful record produced by Chris Hughes. Everything taken to the logical conclusions of what was begun on Olympian.
Yeah.
Steve's guitar solo on Why I Was Born, for instance.
Oh, that's brilliant, that. Yeah, it's an amazing creation. And him and Chris Hughes worked on perfecting that over a long, long period of time, actually. Steve had the original 7/4 timing sort of riff, and him and Chris Hughes worked that up brilliantly.
Yeah, it's recognisably Gene. It's in keeping with what's gone before, but it's much more fluid.
Yeah. I think Chris got him playing over and over again, showed him the best bits that he was playing, and then made him recreate it again, type thing. So they sort of created that solo together. He just picked it out and he went back and played it again. I think that's what happened. But I love the guitar on that song. It is really fluid, as you say.
Martin was on particularly earnest or honest form lyrically in that song too.
Yeah, it was very heartfelt, actually. It's a fantastic lyric from Why I Was Born. It's a love song of the highest order, really.
As you say, there's a common theme on that record, so it's got a great coherence to it, and there's more influences coming in too. I felt you were flexing your muscles in terms of songwriting. Singles Where Are They Now and We Could Be Kings are just terrific.
Yeah, Where Are They Now is my favourite Gene song. It was actually a very hard album to record, that one, and if we'd have had a few more songs going in to recording the album, I think it would have been an absolute classic. There's a few songs on there that aren't quite up there with Where Are They Now, Speak To Me Someone, We Could Be Kings, which are just brilliant pieces of work that I'll always be proud of. I just think we needed to probably wait and write another five songs and pick two or three from them to like make it a slightly better LP. But I suppose bands are always looking for them in hindsight, you know.
You said that I should look to the future. I've seen and I'll stay here. I don't know why I am tied to the winter. Can't find the time to live.
Also on that record, on Drawn to the Deep End, in terms of styles, the band were trying out different things. Like, on the one hand, something like The Accidental was quite experimental. And on the other hand, I Love You, What Are You, which could almost be a Queen song.
Yeah, that's probably my least favourite on the album, actually. I remember some guy coming in, there's a friend of Chris Hughes, had loads of friends turning up. Like, the guy being in Wang Chung turned up. All these people, like, turned up and, you know, very nice guys and sort of helped out. And I don't remember the name of the guy who turned up when we were doing I Love You, What Are You, but he was a quite theatrical Freddie Mercury type character. And I remember him getting on the piano and it sort of, I don't know, we had some fun and it sort of ended up like that. But The Accidental is very much an experimental thing, you know. I remember the drums was quite an interesting plod. It's got a sinister type character about it. And then we actually went out into Chiswick High Road and recorded the road and buses going down to try and give a sense of the streets on it.
Well, it was such a big sounding record that I got the feeling Polydor were pinning quite a lot of expectations on it.
They were. It needed to sell. It cost a lot to make, too much. We didn't need to spend that much money on it, and it put a lot of pressure. It was probably the beginning of the end, actually, in a way, even though it was a very fine record. It costs so much to make that unless it sells a million worldwide pretty quickly, they're going to think it's not done so well, which is a shame because Olympian had not cost very much to make and had made Polydor quite a lot of money. So I think we probably needed to do something in between before we went for the big expensive album. But, you know, hindsight's a wonderful thing.
Well, the next album, Revelations, in 1999, was almost a return to the kind of concise writing of the earlier stuff. So I wondered whether that was a reaction to the, well, I don't want to say failure of Drawn to the Deep End, because it wasn't a failure.
No, it's certainly not a failure. You know, I'm sure it's actually made pretty decent money over the years, but it's not made them a lot of money, which is probably what they really wanted to do.
Was Revelations a reaction to what happened, shall we say, to Drawn to the Deep End?
Yeah, I mean, Polydor realised they may have pushed us a little bit. They did sort of encourage us to go for everything. They didn't hold the wallet back, if you know what I mean. They pushed us to do with expensive videos, expensive everything. And I think they wanted to rein it in. We were like, why have we spent so much? You know, and we've got 27 songs. Let's just record them quickly, like we did with Olympian, to be honest. They wouldn't have let us do anything else but record it very quickly. There wouldn't have been the budget. They listened to the songs and went, if you can do it in a month, we'll keep you. You know, and Revelations was a little bit like that, but great fun to record. I mean, Good as It Gets, we recorded that in one take, and it really does sound like that. You know, it's got an amazing energy to it, that song.
Careful in life,
So the other side of the coin at Polydor, when you left, what happened? Was it an unceremonious dumping, or was it something that you'd seen coming and been waiting for? What was the mood in the camp?
We knew we had a lot of fans. We knew we were selling out tours in America, and we felt very much there was a future. And we knew we had a publishing company behind us, because we'd always sort of, without going too much into band contracts, you know, the publishing song ownership side of it tends to recoup quicker than the actual recording side of it. You know, so we had a publishing company who owned our catalogue that were prepared to stick with us. But we sort of realised that we were going to get dropped by Polydor. And we asked them to hasten us up and let us go, rather than sit on us for a couple of years and then just say goodbye. Because by that time, there may not have been too much profile or interest in the band left. So we sort of asked them to sort of let us go quickly, which thankfully they did.
Well, across these reissues, there's a lot of extra material, B-sides and so on from each album, live versions, radio sessions. But the most interesting stuff is actually on the Libertine extra disc. There's a surfeit of demos and outtakes. It looks to me like coming out of that deal with Polydor actually gave the band a new lease of life.
Yeah, I think we were like, no, we were making a real fight of this. We really thought, we've got loads of good material, we've got loads of good ideas, we're still selling out gigs, we're still doing festivals. There was every reason to continue, really. And Libertine, we recorded with our own publishing money and our own funds, and we didn't skimp on that at all. We took longer than we did for Revelations, and we were paying for it ourselves. We made sure that we did make the album we really wanted to make, you know. And that was, as I was saying earlier, maybe should have been the second sort of album we did, somewhere in between Drawn to the Deep End and Olympian. But yeah, we felt we've got loads of songs, you know, let's make a real fight of it. And I think we did, and, you know, it didn't quite turn out like that, you know, just to promote a record successfully. It takes quite a serious marketing budget, and that's what we didn't have when we finished the whole thing, you know.
It's been interesting to listen to it, actually, because I haven't listened to it for quite a long time. And it's much more rounded than I remember. There's elements of the classic Gene sound, but you're working hard in other directions. And I wondered if you thought that maybe that worked against you, you know, that people had a fixed idea of what Gene was and where Gene belonged. And the times had moved on.
Maybe, I don't know. I don't think we even were listened to that much. Actually, the reviews of Libertine were very good, you know. Just the zeitgeist kind of wasn't there. I think a lot of people just, they'd moved on to other things, yeah. And they, you know, I think, you know, it would be probably a good idea to just take time, not rush into another thing, but all of us became, you know, sort of quite, you know, we weren't on particular wages anymore and things like that. So, you know, the rot had set in, and it was kind of very difficult to work then. Personally, I'm just talking for myself, I think we should have stuck it out and lasted a bit longer. But I think Martin decided that was it, really. And we probably weren't ever going to get back to where we were. But you know, that's where it goes, really, I suppose.
Success and time have done you right. Your flowers bloomed into the place that we see. Once a well-known, but used to need me.
All that material suggests, you know, a rich vein of form, like you're headed towards another album or something.
Yeah, I mean, I've got a mini disc collection of all the sort of pieces of music that I submitted or was working on. Each one of us would bring in ideas to the band forum in the rehearsal room. And we were a very sort of highly democratic band, really. We'd sort of like, this isn't the one of Kev's, this is the one of Matt's. And I've got my mini disc of the stuff I had for songs after Libertine. And I also think maybe I could use that for something else. Yeah. But I've got plenty of like music. And I think all of us, when we, you know, decide, we could all have got writing ability, and I think there certainly could have been more Gene songs. I think even now, if we got back together, we'd probably write about five or six okay ones, and they would take us that amount discarded for we'd write something really good. You know, that's where you got to sort of go for.
Well, we're about to play out with something from what was almost actually the last Gene gig, an emotional night, I remember, at Sheffield Leadmill, May 2004. These reissues will have given you the chance to reassess the five albums. How do you think they stand up in some cases 20 years on?
But I almost say I'm a bit biased. I think they have stood the test of time. I think there are four or five songs on every record that actually sound quite timeless. You know, if I think Sleep Well Tonight and Olympia and you know, Where Are They Now, Speak to Me Someone, there are fantastic things that are worth listening to now. It's not throwaway pop. You know how pop can really date. The music sounds like a proper songwriting band doing music, you know. It's from an era, but I think it still stands up and sounds okay now.
What do you think Gene's legacy is?
I don't really know. That's for other people to judge, you know. I'm not quite sure. I actually think there's a lot of new people who never saw the band as well. I see that on the Facebook. People all over the world who definitely never saw us play at all, and they've probably become fans since 2004 when we split up, which is, I think, that's usually a positive sign for a band. I'm really, really happy that there are still people now who really care about it. They're doing a launch party, and there's people doing fanzines for it, and they're just slightly older than they used to be. But it is quite strange that it's 20 years. It doesn't actually feel like that. It feels like it's a bit of a Gene family. I've been in touch with some of the fans, you know, for the whole time, and one or two of them, I even went to their weddings, and, you know, they had, like, the organist played I Can't Help Myself while they were signing the register. And
were you tempted to set up your kit in the vestibule and hammer along?
But it was a kind of beautiful thing. I've known these kids since they were 15, queuing outside of our venue, and now I'm at their wedding. it's really quite special, actually.
When I'm on my own, and I need my home, you can hold every atom and every limb I own. When I need a friend, can you be that friend? Will you share every sorrow for tomorrow is mine? I can't help myself. Oh, what to do for me? From now on, I will have plenty. I can't help myself, for I'm in love again. Thank you.